Hi guys, good morning. As they introduce, I'm Siddhant, and I'll be talking about a subject that is kind of underrepresented in our country. We don't much think about it. And the best part of the subject is there are two parts into it, which ironically need the most attention, but none of us pay attention to it. It's cultural heritage and disability. So along with my mother, I founded this organization called Access for All. And the aim of Access for All was to bridge the gap between the heritage sites, the monuments, the museums that we go to, and how people with disability could engage in that, could be a part of it, and would not be left out saying that there's no facility for you. Just a question to ask, definition of a disability. And under disability, the most important thing that I feel is that they always highlight it's a limitation. So a lot of times disability is seen as a limitation to do something physically, a limitation to do something mentally. But is that really so? Is disability just limitation? If that was the idea, then I'm sure that she should not have been able to climb up the Himalayas, right? And just be there on the top of the world, literally on the top of the world. She's the first female who, with an amputated leg, went up there, conquered the Himalaya, stood up there to prove that disability is not only about limitations. It's about doing things in a different way. It's having a different ability to do something. So we started working on this, and we realized that the government of India recognizes 21 types of disability. These 21 types of disability would mean that you get a certificate under these categories, and that's it. So are these the only people who would require ramps, who would require braille signage, who would require assistance? No, right? Imagine you're going somewhere and you fall down, you break your leg, you're on a wheelchair, you are using crutches, you would be the participant who would require those facilities, even for that shortest span of time. And that's actually what physical disability means. We all travel to places within the country. We are a multilingual country. You go down south, maybe you don't know the language, then even the simplest way of asking for a toilet, you need to just do this, right? That's a universal language. That's one thing that would tell people. So imagine, like, if you go to a space, you can't read, you can't understand, that's the simplest form of intellectual disability. You can't see what's written up there. So there are ways in which you need to understand that disability is not only about limitations. It's about understanding it in three parts of physical, intellectual, and social. Even not being able to participate in a space is a form of disability. It may be permanent, it may be temporary. Like for example, my mother, she is disabled herself, and it's a permanent disability, but sometimes for those who are on a wheelchair, who can move out just because of fracture, that's a temporary disability. So disability really is not only about limitations, but it's about finding new ways, different ways of being able. It's actually our job as professionals. No matter what you do, in any field you would be, it's your job to figure out a way to make that organization, that space, that work that you're doing, that service more inclusive and more accessible. We have this concept, you know, people with disability are born with disability. But for the fact, like for records, on the contrary, 75% of the population which falls under PWD, which is persons with disability, are those who have acquired disability. It may be because of a biological reason after birth, maybe some other issues because of a disease, or even like an external reason, because of an accident which renders you disabled for the largest part of your life. So, coming back to the story of my mother acquired visual impairment. She is a person with disability. She has 30% distorted vision. And for her, like when she was facing all these issues, I was studying in architecture, I was in my second year, and we realized that the house where she would find her solace became the most uncomfortable space. She would rub against things, she would trip over small thresholds, she would not be able to read something, she would not be able to use the street, the market that she would go after 6:37 because it was too dark and it was poorly lit for her. She has immensely hurt her knees over time because of falling down. She has hurt her knees because there are level differences, the roads are not designed well for them. And these were just issues because considering that even she has 30% vision, she faces all these challenges. Day-to-day life started getting affected. We would travel, but she would be sitting in a place. She would be made to sit, not participate with us. And it's really irritating for us and for the person, because imagine you are enjoying, you are in a museum, you're in an art gallery, you're with your father, you're with your sibling, but your mother's sitting outside. And that's a problem that we realize that a lot of families face, like be it not only for persons with disability, but even senior citizens, that irritation of not being able to participate with everyone. And we started realizing, why is that so? And why, you know, like what all falls under that? And while I was studying in Greece, I got a scholarship to research on creating cultural prototypes, rendering the cultural prototypes for persons with disability so they could engage on the sites. I started my fellowship at City Palace in Jaipur. The idea was to look at the whole museum, and City Palace is very strategically placed in Jaipur, where you have the Hawa Mahal, you have Jantar Mantar, again, key important World Heritage sites in the vicinity. So we did a hardcore audience research to understand what's happening. Are people traveling with their families? Are people traveling with those with disability? And we found out some very interesting numbers, and that is what shaped our practice and has been shaping our practice for past 5 years now. 75% of the population do not get their family members to the site. They would actually keep them at the hotel, or they would actually make them wait in a car or in a vehicle or in the bus. They're like, hum jaake aa jayenge and then we'll take you around. 82% of the groups felt that there was nothing for the kids to do. There was nothing for senior citizens to do. There was actually a very interesting analysis that we did, and we found that the locals felt that andar to raja ke purane kapde hai. That is what the idea was. Arey, hamare liye nahi, ye to jo vilayat se aate, jo ghumne aate, people who are traveling, it is meant for them. And we were like, that's a perception, and through accessibility, that's also about intellectual access, that if you don't feel interested, you're not going to come in. So we realized the final key things that were about the no facility of physical access. You could not come inside. There was no braille, there was no signage, so there was no way that anybody could even come in and read anything. And the last part, which is SLP, which is sign language interpreters. There were no sign language interpreters, so anybody who could see and walk around but could not hear, there was no basic facility for them. We started designing, we started figuring out how should we take it ahead, what should we do. But there was this one question that was tickling me throughout, and that was, what exactly is a special need? So I'm just asking y'all, how many of y'all wear specs? Would you consider yourself as persons with disability? Genuinely. So specs does, what does a specs do? It makes your vision clear, right? And a hearing aid does the same thing. So why a person wearing a hearing aid should be under the bracket of being a person with disability, but not us wearing specs? So that's the idea of the social construct, the social perception that we have towards disability. And that was one thing, that was a core idea that we wanted to change through the work that we have been doing. So we started figuring out how do we work on the pyramid. We realized physical access was important, but not as much. That became the first part of it. So we did accessibility audits. We would look at the site, made sure where the ramps were required, where the lighting was required. Those things were provided. Social access. How do you get everyone to feel that, you know, museums and art galleries are not only for elite, it's not only for those who wear khadi saris and go around. You do not have to wear clothes from Fab India to go there. So people had all those constructs, and all these things that I'm quoting is actually from my research. Like, it's what people have quoted. They felt that, you know, you had to dress up a certain way to go to a museum or an art gallery or even an art opening. So there were various ideas that we had to construct and work upon. So this was providing the ramps, making sure the ramps were clear enough, the signage was clear enough, and you had to even respect it's a heritage site, so you could not just throw in any material. It had to blend with the surrounding, it had to blend into it. Even the signage had to blend with it, it had to be in stone. This was easy. The tough part came now when, with understanding the question of how do you make visual art accessible for a person with visual impairment? How could they engage with that? So we designed, we worked, and we created things where we saw this, please do not touch signs everywhere, but touch was the only way that they would engage with it. So an access to it for a person with low vision was actually through touch. So let's bring in that on, and we designed these kind of tactile artworks in the museum space, in a space where you're not allowed to touch, but we designed these kind of plaques which you could touch, feel, and understand. You could touch and feel the Maharaja's pagdi, the regalia around him, the jewels, the motikaha, the satlada, everything. And what we were seeing, people with visual impairment could touch and feel and read about it through Braille. We created India's first museum Braille book, and it's India's first museum Braille book because it had Braille, it had large script font, and it had tactile images. Through our research, we had realized that almost 78% of the visually impaired people are traveling with escorts. They would have somebody along with them. So while the person with visual impairment was reading it, reading the Braille, the other person became visually impaired because he did not know Braille. So we kind of fused the two things together. So you can even read, the book was launched at the City Palace by the Princess Diya Kumari as part of CAM, which is the Commonwealth Associations of Museums program, which we had a workshop there. And as part of this, to make a larger impact, and it really made a larger impact because it gave us the first chance to create Pakistan's first museum Braille book. Here, the people could not come to the museum. They had their own challenges because of safety concerns in Karachi. They did not move around. So we thought, why not take the museum to them? So we designed a Braille book where you could have the numismatic collection right from the Indus Valley seals to the current currency notes in a tactile format where they could touch, feel, read about it, and read about it in Braille. So the museum actually came to you, and that's the second level of accessibility. If you can't take somebody to the context, get the context to them. So we worked on that, and that was a small way of bridging the gap also between two nations. We launched various such programs accordingly after that because we realized that people with special needs, schools majorly, were not able to take the kids outside. They didn't have funding, they had certain issues, because of which they were rendered immobile and could not go. So we thought, why not bring the Kerala, why not bring the state to them in the school? And we designed an entire tactile kit with Braille books, with audio guides, where they could touch and feel and get a sense of what the state offered. How does it feel? What is a houseboat? What is the material? And the tactile artwork has Braille. It has the things that you can touch and feel, so that you get a sense of what things are available over there. One of the most important things in a museum or in any space, we realized that it was not only about providing access, but even changing people's mindset. We always thought that, you know, oh, it's accessibility, oh, it's charity. Accessibility is not charity. It need not always be associated with that. It's about a person's right. It's about being or giving that person dignity, you know, being there and being able to understand as in how we do. So we thought, let's put people in their space, and we started doing these workshops, which are multi-sensory workshops. This is from Baudhaji Lad Museum here in Mumbai, where we do a blindfold museum visit. You're blindfolded, you're made to experience the museum, and instead of sight, you understand the museum through smell, through sound, through touch, even in some cases through taste. So you use all your other senses to be part of the cultural landscape of the museum. We make you hear things, you follow a line, and it is at that time that people started realizing what are the difficulties that anybody else would face while they were in the museum. How does one like suddenly become more aware of their other senses when they were there? This was a very interesting project that we worked upon. We were invited to Malaysia in Sarawak Island and Kuching. There was this Pustaka Nagari Bukuru. It was a very large children's literature festival. And the best part of this children's literature festival was that they made sure that it was inclusive. There were books for everyone, so they wanted books for even kids with visual impairment. So we were commissioned to work on a project where we created India's first tactile Indian art book, which you could feel the traditional Indian art forms of Gond, Madhubani, Varli, which you could touch and feel and get a sense of how it is, what were the shapes, what were the designs and patterns in it, and read about it. So there was an organization called Sarmaya who supported this initiative, and we were able to take it there in a different country and take our cultural heritage from here to there, along with the tactile artworks of modern masters. So be it, here you see an Ara, where they're not only touching the flower and getting the sense of what the vase is, but even smelling it. Being part of that, you know, where you not only touch and feel, but even smell and engage more with the artwork. This is a recent project. Recently, Kochi Biennale just concluded yesterday, and we were working on the inclusion at Kochi Biennale. How can you make an art festival more inclusive, more accessible for persons with special needs? And we realized that Biennale is in a set of space. Not everybody could come in there, so what all could we do? We had a tactile reproduction, there were braille books available, there was a tactile map available. But we realized that if we really want to make an impact, we started working on schools around. We knew that the schools would not get in because they face their own limitation of transport, of funding, of the, even the time to spend, you know, from coming from one part to another part of Kochi. So we were like, no worries, we'll come to you. And we started doing these art-based therapy programs that we specialize in, where we use traditional Indian art forms and use the principles of art-based therapy to talk about different things. So how can we render their fine motor skills? How can we work on their hand and eye coordination? And there were a series of projects. So in the span of 8 days, we worked with over 800 kids with over 15 schools across Kochi. And even we conducted blindfold experiences for almost 500 people in Kochi as visitors. They were given blindfolds and made to access art and touch and feel them. So we did blindfold photography, we do blindfold clay modeling, blindfold sketching. So just to break that notion that these are things, even though they are very visual, you could do it without them. So these were things that they made. So these are things made by kids with visual impairment in the blind school over there. And then similarly, we did the same thing with the sighted people, where they were blindfolded and were made to recreate things that from their imagination. And along with that, these are other projects that we've started working on with the schools, with special schools and on different CSR projects. So we work on organize with different groups like Lions Group, Rotary. We work with different organizations like Standard Chartered, IndusInd. And even like organizations like Goldman Sachs, where they think of doing their programs, their marketing programs, their in-house programs, HR programs, but with a bent of a social curve. So this is a book. This was one of the first kits that was developed on menstrual hygiene. How would you talk about this concept? There are certain concepts which are not spoken about. Teachers are really shy to talk about these things in school because they're like, we don't know how to go ahead. So we designed an entire tactile kit which was teach them, you know, which would help them teach the girls about different flows of the day, how to use the pad, what to use, what are the issues, what is happening biologically. And it was all there through a braille book. And the braille book is more like a discussion between two people. It's like a story that you're reading rather than somebody telling you and guiding you, this is what you have to do. So it automatically broke the whole barrier between a teacher and a student. And this storybook, then you enter with tactile aids and you could clear the concepts of it. So till date, this is some of the numbers in past 5 years. This is what we've worked with. We've worked across from Kashmir to Kerala. We've worked in a wide span. We've worked Pakistan, Malaysia, even some programs in China. So the idea is to bring that network of people to understand that accessibility can be a part of it. And finally, I would like to conclude with these two things, because the platform is about ideas, and the idea about how, like, if things applied, can really make a difference. So this is just a picture of my mom on a trip. She came to meet me at City Palace in Jaipur. And in the last part, I gifted her a book, which is a tactile guidebook, which she could touch and feel the monuments, which she could read about them in Braille very easily. And it was where we suddenly, like, by the time she came, that there were all these signs saying, please touch, instead of the old signs which you saw about please do not touch. And now the guidebook is going to be created into a formal guidebook for people with visual impairment by a UK-based travel organization who wants to promote travel itineraries for visually impaired people in Rajasthan. So the simplest idea of universal design is that if you apply your mind, if you apply your mind in the right way, you can really make a difference. You can design literally for everyone. This is like a small Lego-based wheelchair from an organization in Ohio who's working on making sure that even animals have the right of movement, freedom, and mobility. So that's the tiny little wheelchair because this creature cannot use the limbs at the back. And along with this, what's happening is this, where people don't understand what common sense is, and we design ramps like these. Where they, because the contractor was told that he's supposed to make a stepped ramp, he thought he made a perfectly designed ramp. He cut it and added a step to it. And the idea was that, arey, amagar aapne to step ramp karne ko bola tha. So that's the idea. Like, if you don't apply your brain, it's pure common sense. And if you apply your brain, you can really make a difference. You can really change that experience that anybody could have anyway. Thank you so much, guys. On that note, I conclude. Thank you so much.